Tara,
I'm in a hailstorm of different ideas about God. It used to be more binary, God exists or God doesn't exist. Now, there are all these different concepts of pantheism, panentheism, value, deism. Does that advance us in our understanding?
Well, the question I'd want to press you with is, what do you expect of a notion of God? As opposed to, say, a notion of blip or blop. You know, we can sit back in our armchairs and have a fantastically exciting intellectual set of speculations about notions of that without which there wouldn't be nothing. But what really excites us as humans about God, it strikes to me, if we're properly to call this God, is some being that demands a transformation of our life. So if we had a belief in a blob who simply set the whole thing going but was fundamentally uninterested in us or maybe even malicious, this would not be a vision of a person who is calling us into some kind of transformation of perspective, of moral virtue. And I would want to ask you, would that satisfy you?
Well, there's a coherence in what you say, but yet I feel that's a second step.
Mm-hmm.
It's not a first step, because whether that satisfies me or whether I am repelled by it is an emotional response. I don't want to have that. What I want to have is a reality. If the reality I like, I'll be happy. If I don't like, I'm going to adjust to it, because it's a reality.
What you want is what is true.
I want what is true. Mm. And I worry that if I have affective responses to it, that I would begin to doubt whether that is true.
Well, I see your point. You don't simply want a God made in your own image who will comfort you,
right,
who then becomes dispensable if you find a nicer one. On the other hand, I think you're wrong to suggest that any decision about God can be made purely by ratiocination and not by affective response.
All right, but let's go into the specifics. Pantheism, where God is the world and it seeks to deal with the problem of evil or deal with the integration of science in a more natural way, and panentheism, which gives God greater space than pantheism in a way.
Well, I think what you need is a checklist of what you might call existential or philosophical problems that you want solved by whatever God is going to satisfy you. But you also need a checklist of the criteria or conditions under which you would be swayed. So, is the God whom you are likely to believe in one for whom the evidences seem the most convincing, or is it a notion that is logically compelling, or is it the notion that is most coherent, takes account of the widest dimensions of factors in your life and holds together, or is it again a notion that is aesthetically attractive and pleasing?
Yeah, okay.
These were all criteria.
And I think they're all all legitimate. I just would try to keep myself out of it as much as possible and try to judge it on its third person act, not on a second person or a first person level.
Yes, I think
maybe that's impossible.
Well, I think that is actually ultimately impossible. But I understand your legitimate desire to be as dispassionate as possible in the first instance. What I want to suggest is that it's extremely hard, absolutely, to abstract from practitioner commitment when making these decisions. In fact, I think it's ultimately foolish to try and do that, because there is something about the integration of life commitments and questioning rational philosophical considerations that we search for in religious and philosophical questions. And those who claim that they're absolutely uncommitted emotionally to that which they argue always strike me as highly unconvincing.